And thank you again to Dietrich and Jean-Philippe for organizing this nice conference. So yes, this will be a kind of continuation on the lecture that I gave last week. And I will, concerning new results, I will describe some work in progress with Michal Vrochna on the construction of Hadamard states through characteristic Cauchy data. Of course, I cannot. I will try to do a very brief resume of the framework. So, start with Klein-Gordon fields on a manifold. So, Klein-Gordon, this could be wave equation. It's just the wave equation. I'm not interested in this problem with. This is the mass is completely irrelevant here. So the setup is as follows. So you have a globally hyperbolic spacetime. And a Klein-Gordon type operator. So here, the only condition is that R is a smooth function, and it is a real valued. Also, if you want, you can also couple with electromagnetic field, and then this will not be a real operator anymore. But nevertheless, we will look always at complex solutions. So I will first recall some, I always already explained these things last week, but I recall them anyway. So by sol sc of p is the space of c infinity space compact solutions. Of PU equals zero. So space compact means that there are several definitions. So maybe the best definition is that the intersection of the support with any Cauchy surface is compact. Okay. So these are solutions which correspond to smooth compact Cauchy data. Okay. So very nice solutions. And so there is a conserved, I recall the conserved current. If you have two solutions, and you, this is really related to the symplectic form. V2. So this is conserved. Yes. This is conserved current if PU equals zero, and this allows to equip this space with the symplectic form, which is U1 sigma U2. Okay, so for me, a symplectic form is anti-Hermitian Sesquilinear form, right? Not a real symplectic form, which is an integral over a Cauchy surface of this conserved current contracted with unit normal. So then this makes this becomes a symplectic space. And then I recall the two other versions of this symplectic space, so two natural symplectic spaces which are isomorphic to this one. So the first version is a Cauchy surface version. So you fix a Cauchy surface, sigma, and you take the trace operator, which maps, let's say, a smooth space compact function to heat restriction and I inverse, I mean, the first 1 over I times the forward normal derivative. And then you have you know that rho sigma maps the space compact solutions to direct sum of test functions. And the Cauchy problem is solvable, so you have an inverse U sigma inverse, which is a solution of the Cauchy problem. And then it's obvious that this is really, if you fix this Cauchy surface, then this is really, we get a symplectic, so let's call this F. So we can write this also rho U1 rho U2, so rho UI is FI, and you this is the usual symplectic form. You couple the this is position component, this is the momentum component. Okay, so this is this is essentially the same as this one, and it's convenient to do computations, but of course it's not covariant. And then there is the more useful version, which is the space-time version. And which can be rephrased as follows. So E plus minus are the two forward and or back. Wait a second. Okay, let's use the standard terminology, retarded, advanced, fundamental solutions. Of P. And then you form E, which is E plus minus E minus. And you note that it is anti-Hermitian. If you use the scalar product, the natural scalar product on the manifold. I mean, this comes from the fact that P is self-adjoint for this scalar product. And then the best way is to, there is a statement that can be nicely written. I mean, what I explain is very well known. I mean, it's essentially due to De Moc, I think. One can summarize a lot of statements by saying that this is an exact sequence. And in particular, this means that if I take the space of test function, so I this tells you that E is surjective, so any space compact solution is obtained by applying E to a test function. The kernel is the range of the image of P, the image of a test function under P. So this means that this is isomorphic with a space compact solution. But moreover, you can decorate this with the symplectic forms. So here I put sigma. And here, what you get as a symplectic form is exactly E. Okay. So that's very good, because now instead of working with solutions, you work with test functions. This is so the statement that this is a symplectic. Okay. So now I should, what you do with this? So this is essentially it's not much. I mean, you have just interpreted the space of solution as a symplectic space, and then this means that you can start the quantization. And this is also very easy. And so I'll very, very quickly come to states. So the quantization, it is as follows. You take X sigma, a complex symplectic space. And what you do is that you associate two vectors of X, symbols or operators, like this. So these are called the charge fields. The condition is that U maps to psi of U is antilinear. So U maps psi star of U is linear. And the famous commutation relation, so two psi fields commute. Two psi star fields commute also. And if you commute a psi with a psi star, you get I U1 bar sigma U2 identity. And this is, it is useful to consider I sigma. This is called the charge. And this is now Hermitian. Okay, so this is exactly like the canonical commutation relation written in terms of creation annihilation. The difference is that this is not typically not positive. Okay. Okay. So then you can construct an abstract algebra, which is given by sums of products of these fields, and consider states on this algebra. And the easiest states to consider are the quasi-free states, which are. Wait a second, just the quasi-free states. So you have some algebra to see, and they are defined by their two-point functions, so by the action on the product of two fields. So I recall the formulas. So if I apply the state to a product of two psi fields or two psi star fields, I get zero. So this is a consequence of the gauge invariance of the state. And so I just need to tell what happens when I apply omega to a product of a psi and a psi star. So this I denoted by U1 bar lambda plus U2. And I can also exchange the places of psi and psi star. And this is U1 bar lambda minus U2. And there is no reason to distinguish, to prefer one of these over the other. So we can, it's better to keep them together. So this we call complex, a pair of complex covariances. And as I explained last week, then you have one condition which comes from the commutation relation, which is lambda minus equal to q. And another condition which comes from the positivity, which says that the both lambda plus and lambda minus are positive. Okay? Right? So this is true on, this works on any symplectic space, so we can try to apply it to this one. So this leads to the free Klein-Gordon field, so to speak. And So there is one. A bit of explanation. So this lambda plus minus will be sesquilinear form on this space. Okay. So since we like distributions, we can require that there will be actually sesquilinear forms on the bigger space C0 infinity of M. You add continuities and you get by Schwarz theorem, you get distributions. And then if you require that these forms upstairs should pass to quotients, so they should be in the kernel of P. So eventually, you get that a state for free Klein-Gordon fields is given by a pair of distributions on M cross M, such that P lambda plus minus equal lambda plus minus P is zero. Lambda plus minus lambda minus is I times E. Recall E is a symplectic form. I times E, that's a charge. And lambda plus minus is positive. I mean, this is now not really a sesquilinear form, but an operator. So I use a scalar product on M to define this. Okay. So then there are plenty of states. And among them are the Hadamard states, which are the substitute for the vacuum states. And which are characterized by the wavefront set of the two-point functions as follows. So you look at the principal symbol of your Klein-Gordon operators, and you have the characteristic manifold, P inverse of zero, in the cotangent bundle. And to define E plus and E minus, we have to choose a time orientation. The time orientation gives me also a kind of energy orientation, so I can distinguish between positive energy, negative energy. So N is a disjoint union of the positive negative energy shell. Energy. Okay. And the Hadamard condition is simply, there is one more bit of notation. If let's say x1, x2 are points in the cotangent bundles, and x1 equivalent to x2 means that xi are in N, and they are on the same integral curve of the Hamiltonian. Okay, so they are on the same by characteristic. Okay, good. Then what is the Hadamard condition? It's the following one. That's I take the wavefront set of lambda plus minus. I take the primed version, which I explained last week. And actually, you can put just included, such that x1 equivalent to x2 and x1, x2 are in N plus minus. Okay. So that's the Hadamard condition. Very good. Okay. Now I explained last week that if you have the Hadamard condition, then there are a lot of things that you can do with these states. For example, you can define weak powers of fields. You can define the renormalized stress energy tensor. So these states are really considered now as important reference states for perturbative computations. Okay. Now the question is how to construct Hadamard state. So I will be, a bit quicker. So the construction. So essentially, you just add to these three conditions, you add this one. Okay. So what are the known constructions? So there is a deformation argument. F and W, it's a Fuling, Narkovich, and Wald argument. So this tells you that on any space-time there exist plenty of Hadamard states, but it's not explicit. I mean, you have absolutely no access to the two-point function of this Hadamard states. But I mean, it's good to know that this is okay. You can use a construction using a Cauchy surface. Sigma, there was a work from 97 by Junker, and we gave probably a different, slightly different construction with Michel Rochner. So I think I explained more or less this construction last week. So this relies, it's a bit, this relies on the construction of a detailed parametrics for the Cauchy problem. So you still you have to work quite a bit. And in fact, there is a third construction, which is by, so-called conformal compactification. And this construction was developed by the Italian school, and it started with Walter Moretti and various papers in collaboration with Claudio da Piaggi, Nicola Pinamonti, and also many students. It's written correctly. So this is, last year I looked at all these papers. I found them very intriguing. And I will explain more or less the idea, and then I will explain what we did about this this method. So this is quite flexible. And the idea is as follows. So essentially you have to assume that P is has some conformal invariant. So P is a conformal, for example, conformal wave equation. And that Mg is asymptotically flat. Okay, so, and then you do a conformal transformation. You are reduced to this situation. Then it is obvious that the symplectic spaces will move correctly under this transformation. And then the thing is that, this Mg is the interior. Okay, so I draw this famous. It's like this. So this is M. And then you have a larger manifold M tilde. And you have a C, which is a null hypersurface. And of course, you have these two problematic points here, E plus and I zero. So in this in this question, I zero plays absolutely no role because we look at space compact solutions, so they will never hit the spatial infinity. But I plus plays a role. So if you want really a watertight result. So either you have to assume that this is asymptotically flat with smooth future infinity, or if it's not the case, then you have to, in a concrete situation, like for example in Schwarzschild, which was analyzed also by these people. Then you have to work to do some extra work to show that nothing bad happens at I plus. Okay. And the thing is that now you are in this situation, like this, and you take a Cauchy surface, and a solution of the wave equation will have a trace on the null boundary C, and you want to define a state inside the cone by a state on the cone, so a state which will act on the traces of the solution on the boundary. Okay. Okay. So what we did is, in fact, it was, at least for me, it was motivated by the desire to understand these papers. Was to look at the situation after this compactification. So now it's the setup is as follows. So more or less, it's like we are looking at a kind of characteristic Cauchy problem. So we have, again, Mg globally hyperbolic. We fix a point P in M. And we take M0, which is time-like past of P, and C, which is the boundary of the causal past of P minus P itself. So this is this P. This is C, and inside you have M0. And so you can look in the literature at the condition of, I think it's a condition due to Friedrich of a smooth time infinity. So these are the assumptions. So you require that there is a smooth function in M such that C is included in F inverse of 0. Df is not zero on C. I mean, note that P is not, the tip of the cone does not belong to the cone. You can at least normalize up to a constant by this condition. So this tells you that the Taylor expansion of F at the tip of the cone is the thing that you believe. I mean, the usual. Well, at least if, for example, if you work in normal coordinates. And the important condition is that this vector field is complete on C, and this means that C will be actually here C is, by definition, it's a smooth manifold. But this is convenient. So note that, C, sorry. Do I miss something? No, okay. So C is a null hypersurface, so this is actually tangent to the cone. Okay. And now our new spacetime is M0G. Okay. Okay, then the construction starts with a null. You have first to construct a null coordinates in a neighborhood of C. So they do not need to be defined in, this neighborhood could get very thin. I mean, it's really a neighborhood of C, so it can be very thin. here. So you can find coordinates f, s, and theta. So this is, this is a bizarre statement. I mean just that theta is actually a map from a neighborhood of the cone C into the unit sphere near C, such that if I look at the metric over C, it will be minus 2 df ds. Theta d theta g. So usually in the literature, one further arranges, there is a lot of freedom for the choice of this coordinate. One further arranges so that this is independent on S and equal to the round metric on the sphere. But for our purpose, it's not necessary to do this. And okay, so now I want to, I have still the same situation, so I have my symplectic space inside the cone, so the space of space compact solutions. So I choose a Cauchy surface sigma zero, and obviously any solution will have a trace on the cone, and I want to identify what is a symplectic form in terms of the on the cone. This is an easy computation. You find that if you use a Stokes formula, you find that if I have two solutions, so recall that this is integral of GA U1, U2, and A d sigma. And you find that it will be equal to where is it? Yes. Okay, just a small. Okay, so if I mean, from these are coordinates in the neighborhood of C, but I will just use S and theta to parameterize C. So S theta maps the cone to R times S D inverse, and this I will denote it often by C tilde. Okay. So I find that this is equal to the integral on C tilde of rod R F G 1 2 G 1 half ES D theta. And if I perform the computation using the form of the metric near C, I get a very simple expression, which is the integral over C tilde R of U1 bar, sorry, dS U2 minus dS U1 bar U2 H1 half dS. Okay. Good. Now it's one would like to replace this measure, which is a measure on the sphere depending on S, by the round measure, and this is easy. We can just multiply. So if this is a round metric on the sphere, then I can introduce the prefactor beta, which is M 1 fourth H minus 1 fourth. And instead of taking the traces of a solution, I can multiply by them by beta inverse. So I denote rho, which maps the solution to beta inverse U restricted to C and written in the coordinate S theta. Okay? Wait a second. Now you see that how does beta inverse behave? Beta inverse behaves like e to the s over something. So this means that this function will be vanishing very quickly near s equal minus infinity. And then you have similar vanishing of derivatives. And there is absolutely nothing to do because you can just use that u is a smooth function in the neighborhood of the cone and work out the change of coordinates. So you need a convenient space to receive. So here this will be a space compact solution, and I am absolutely unable to characterize its the range of space compact solution under rho. I mean, this is, but I don't need to. I can take a bigger space, not too big, because otherwise I may have problems, but any convenient space. And this one is very convenient. So here, I will take something we call h of c tilde, which is the intersection over all integers of the Sobolev spaces on c tilde. Recall that c tilde is this is r cross s t e. Okay. And then what we have just shown. Okay, so I should just explain why this is innocent. Why this this change will replace this measure by m 1/2. I mean, that's obvious because, I mean, the extra derivatives of the beta inverse will cancel by the subtraction, okay? So what do I get? I get that rho. So I get the space compact solution into h of c tilde. Sorry, here I put sigma. And here I put sigma c, which is, I'll write it here, so this will be let's call it V, because these are not the traces of solutions. V, and here is M. So this means I can just put ds d theta. D theta, that's the usual round measure. Okay. This is symplectic. So with quotation marks, because usually symplectic means that it is surjective, but here I remove the surjectivity, of course. So I'm just saying that it preserves the symplectic form. This implies that it is injective, but of course not not surjective. Good. And then we can now we will use this space as our symplectic space. So we do the same procedure. We can take a state here and pull it back to a state inside in a very simple way. So in this way, so I take a sequence of maps from h of c tilde to its dual. And lambda plus minus will be simply rho composed with E0 star, lambda plus minus, rho composed with E0. Okay. Okay. Now, the first question is, we want this to be Hadamard. So what conditions, what are sufficient conditions on this pair of covariance on the cone, to which implies that the capital lambda plus minus will be Hadamard. And this is much easier than if you take a Cauchy surface, because for a Cauchy surface, this will be a space of pairs of functions. So this will be 2 by 2 matrices. It's much more delicate. Here, this will be just scalar operators. And there is no need for any parametric construction. And I'm running out of time. So maybe I will just write the statement and then try to explain it. Yes, yes, but I still have something 5 pages. So what are the conditions on? So there would be obviously there will be condition on the wavefront prime of the distributional kernel of these things. So you have to assume a first global condition which is quite innocent. So this, well, I mean, this is typically always the case for most operators that you can think of. And so this is to be able to do some composition. I mean, if you use the Hermander results, then you cannot only compose properly supported kernels with restriction on the wavefront set. But if you can have a bit of global information, you can also compose non-properly supported kernels. And you have to assume this is condition one, and then two, which is the following. So the lambda plus minus should have no wavefront set in, and then here notation for the cotangent space. So so I have my coordinates f, s, theta. I write them as r, s, and y. And the dual variable will be rho, sigma, and eta.
Okay.
So the condition is that plus or minus, if I intersect the wavefront set with either, let's say, sigma 1 positive or sigma 2 positive, this should be empty. And if I intersect the wavefront set with sigma 1 negative and plus or minus sigma 2 negative, this should be included in the diagonal. Okay? So this means this operator should kill, for example, lambda plus, should kill anything which is at positive sigma and should not move the negative sigma. Okay? And this is 2b. And in fact, if you know that you can look what is lambda plus minus lambda minus. So this should be the charge, but you note that the charge is actually minus 2ds. This is dual variables 2s, yes, okay. So you know that lambda plus minus lambda minus, this is minus 2 times ds, okay? So it has a very simple wavefront set. And using this, you can show that if you add this condition, then you can erase this. This second condition will follow from the first by some kind of playing around. Okay, so what is... I think this was already known, I think, but so I will just explain it briefly. So you take a point in the cotangent space of the cone. So there is a first argument which is due to Walter Moretti, is that, of course, I mean, here you should worry about the singularity of the tip of the cone. I mean, you are taking a trace to a non-smooth manifold, but you can prove that there are no null geodesic which go from inside the cone to the tip of the cone. And this means that if you are just interested in the wavefront set of this thing, since this kernel has a wavefront set related with null geodesics, the tip of the cone is irrelevant. I mean, you can cut off everything away a neighborhood of the tip of the cone, and this will not change the wavefront set. Okay, then I take a point y in t star c tilde, so y is s y and sigma eta. And recall that what is p, at least if f equals 0, it is equal to minus 2 sigma rho plus h inverse of so you look, if sigma is equal to 0, and if you now you want to leave this point to a point in the characteristic manifold of P, right? Because this is only the only points which will propagate inside. So if sigma is equal to 0, so you lift by choosing a rho here, but you find that this will be 0. This is elliptic. So this means that sigma is equal to 0, and the lifting will belong to the conormal bundle to C, and then the bicharacteristic curve will stay in C, of course, right? Okay, so the sigma equals 0 plays absolutely no role. You may have singularities at sigma equals 0, but they will never be felt inside the light cone. And then you check that if sigma is negative, then you will lift. This means that you lift in n plus, and if sigma is positive, you lift in n minus. And the change of sign is come from the fact that we take a backward light cone, not a forward light cone. And out of this, you get the fact that this condition implies that lambda plus minus is Hadamard. Okay. Right. Good. Now we want to find. I write the condition. So we want to find. We should have this. We should have lambda plus minus positive, and lambda plus minus lambda minus is minus 2 times ds plus Hadamard condition. Okay. So. A natural class of operators is we should try pseudo-differential operators on the cone, right? I mean, because here we have the diagonal, right? I mean, this should be operators with at least in a part of the phase space will not, we have a relation equal to the identity. So why not try pseudo-differential operators? So, of course, there are many pseudo-differential operators on R cross SD inverse, right? And so to see what which class to use, well, you have to look at these states that appeared in all these works by Walter Moretti and collaborators, which I write the two-point function. So the state is given by the two-point function is simply Sorry, the distributional kernel is this. So this is a distributional kernel of lambda plus minus. Well, what is this? This is exactly this. You find that the operator is plus or minus 2ds 1r, probably minus plus of Okay, so you should have this operator should be in your calculus. Okay, so it turns out that one should not use a homogeneous calculus on R cross SD inverse, but it is sometimes called a bisingular calculus. So B homogeneous, I mean, different homogeneity within. In here and here. Okay. So just So we have a calculus, I think. I can just write, this will be more or less obvious what it means. So this is, okay, so I'm not going to comment on the meaning of this tensor product, but I mean, it's clear what it means. So what I mean by this, I mean that here I take symbols, okay, which are usual symbols or usual operators on the sphere, and here I use uniform version, the uniform calculus on the line, right? So for example, this will correspond to symbols. So this recall this one denoted by eta symbols S, Y, sigma, eta, such that if I differentiate in S, sorry, d alpha 1 s, d alpha 2 y, d beta 1 sigma, d beta 2 eta, this will behave like sigma to the p1 minus beta, beta 1, and eta to the p2 minus beta 2. Okay? This is a nice class, but I mean, here we have some sharp cutoffs, and then it is convenient to take pseudo differential operators on the sphere whose symbols are operators on the real line, but which are not necessarily pseudo differential. You have to do that. Okay, now where am I? Okay, so we have a class, I mean, for example, I will just... This is a class which show up, so... what are the symbols? They are, so this is... I take pseudo-differential operators on the sphere. The symbols are operators on the line, which are infinitely smoothing. But I don't care about the commutation with x, right? Just infinitely smoothing. And, okay, now I will not speak about these duplicate operators. Okay, and then now, once you have these classes, you can generate Hadamard states. It's not very difficult, as follows. So Q is minus 2 ds. So this is 2 ds to the 1/2. Times sorry, this equal minus, here I have the sign of ds, and then 2ds to the 1/2. I mean, this factor is innocent. I mean, it's clear that it will not change the wavefront set, so I can assume that I can look for my two-point function under this form. Okay, and then the condition becomes C plus minus positive, and C plus minus C minus is equal to minus sine of dx. Okay. Now, I would like to further diagonalize this operator, and this is obvious by the Fourier transform. Minus sine of ds, this is equal to identity 0, 0 minus identity. And what this means that I take the Fourier transform in S and then separate the positive axis and the negative axis, okay? If I do this type of changes to these pseudo-differential classes, I get what is called the Toeplitz operators, right? I mean, a version partial Toeplitz operators. Okay. So, I mean, if I take an operator in this class or in that class, and I do this Fourier transform and splitting, then I can always view it as operators acting on my original Hilbert space. I take my function, I cut the negative, let's say negative frequency, apply my operator, and then extend by zero in the positive frequency. Okay. So now I should look at, for example, a matrix C as C plus plus, C plus minus, and this will be C plus minus star, C minus minus. And then it's very easy to analyze these conditions. So you have the positivity, the difference of the C plus minus C minus should be this 2x2 matrix and the wavefront set condition. And this, okay, now I finally write some theorem. Then here are the mass states. So I take C plus plus to be A plus star A plus, C minus minus to be identity plus A minus star A minus, and C plus minus equals C minus plus star equal A plus star D A minus, where A plus minus are in psi minus infinity zero of C tilde, and they should be decorated here by symbols plus minus because they act not on L2 of C but on the part various parts, and norm of D is less than one. And then if I take C plus to be C plus plus C plus minus C minus minus, so C plus is given by this C minus, that's C, that's C plus plus sine of DS. Then lambda plus minus are radar. Okay. So I get a two-point function on the cone, which inside will generate Hadamard states. Okay. Good. Now there is the important issue of the pure Hadamard states, because you can always generate Hadamard states by convex combination. So really the important one are the extremal. So the pure Hadamard states. And here we can characterize them completely. And I should finish with this. So the purity. So there are two things, two issues. I will comment on this in a minute. So there is a purity on the cone. So this means the purity of the state on the cone, not inside, because these two notions are different a priori. And you can show that a state omega C is pure. So in this class, if and only if C plus is of the form A star A, 1 plus A star A, 1 half A star A1 plus A star A, 1 half, and 1 plus A star, where A star A is an operator of order minus infinity 0 on C tilde. Okay. So, I mean, strictly speaking, you have to look at operators which have pseudo-differential covariance in this version, and if they are poor, then necessarily they are of this form. Now there is an important issue of the purity inside the cone, right? I mean, a priori it is possible that a state, because this is embedding of the symplectic space inside to the symplectic space on the cone was not bijective, so it's possible that a state is pure on the cone, but not pure inside. Okay. And in fact, we can show that all these states are pure also inside the cone. Theorem. So the state, let's say omega m0 induced by omega c is pure also. So I have no time to explain. I will just explain it in words. So this is an issue connected with the density of the traces of smooth space compact solution into a Hilbert space, which actually will be ds to the 1/2 times L2 of C tilde. So it's a homogeneous Sobolev space. Okay. And to show this density, one way is to, there you need some results about the characteristic Cauchy problem. And what we did is that we adapted the result by Hermander in our situation. So what we have to solve is the characteristic Cauchy problem with vanishing data on, so you take a Cauchy surface and you take solutions which vanish on the boundary of this Cauchy surface. The traces will vanish on the boundary of the of this okay. And by using the result of Hermander, you can show that the energy space here is mapped bijectively to the energy space on the cone. Now you have to work out the change of coordinates and the prefactor to see what this H1 space becomes after everything is done. And you find that the topology is much stronger than this topology. And you finish by noting that here you have the energy space, but with Dirichlet boundary conditions, so the test functions are dense in this energy space. Okay. So in this way, you can get purity inside the cone from the purity on the cone in a general framework. Okay, so I have to stop, and thank you for your attention.